The life of Eric Zahn is coming along nicely. The game, I mean, not Eric Zahn's actual life. Here's where it's at. I deliberately reduced the number of colours in some of the art in order to create a dithering effect because I happen to like it. I think it creates the grungy retro vibe I want to bring across. Do you like the buildings? I used pictures of Parisian buildings for reference. Those Frenchies seem to really like metal balcony railings on windows that don't have balconies. So far, I've established the day-night cycle, the basic core gameplay loop of playing the violin, and created an appropriate soundscape. So now all that's in place, let me talk you through a day in the life of Eric Zahn. It all starts with the sky. The sky graphic is actually a very long strip, several times taller than the game screen, that tracks downwards, going through several sky color gradients, transitioning from day to evening to night and back again. This is handy because it means the sky strip's y-coordinate can double as the in-game timer. So the point when the sky strip is 100 pixels deep is when the sun first appears, and the progress the sun makes from top of sky to behind horizon is used to calculate two other effects: the extent of the orange tint that gets added to everything, and the transparency of the shadow that appears on the buildings. The shadows are just the streets being drawn again, but entirely black and shifted down a bit. Quick and dirty, but it does the job. Now, before sunset, this is the ambient noise. The roar of a city full of people going about their business. After sunset, that fades and gives way to this. The slightly eerier sound of distant people talking indoors, because everyone's home from work. Created very simply by taking a sample of people talking, going into the equalizer, and removing everything but the bass. The next sound event is not the addition of sound, but the subtraction of it. See, all along you've been hearing this generic wind sound, which you probably didn't notice, but with its removal, a sense of unnatural stillness is added. The creepy voices continue for a bit, but then they too fade to silence, and the fun can begin. The guiding principle behind the nighttime phase is order into chaos. The harsh lines of the windows give way to a rounded glow effect, and their regimented positions begin to shift impossibly. At the same time, the harsh lines of the city's silhouette is broken up by a shifting black fog effect. So far, there's only one kind of threat that appears, a line marked by another black fog effect that hijacks some of the window lights. The lights tremble to show that they're in trouble and will start to disappear if left unchecked. Playing the violin with the bow roughly angled parallel to the line gradually soothes the effect, reduces the tremble, and eventually frees the windows. The windows are reality's health bar. If all of them go away, it's game over. There are two main ambient sounds here: the buzz, which is the hum from a fluorescent light pitch shifted down, and a generic clang marking a regular sort of corrupted heartbeat, also pitched down with bass and reverb added. When it comes to making scary ambient sounds, bass, reverb, and pitch shifting are my three musketeers. So what's left to do is make more escalating threats, get the daytime gameplay done, and balance all the number juggling. Last time, someone made the valid point that the idea of having to balance sleep to restore energy and study to unlock new abilities doesn't work with an infinite gameplay model, because at some point there will be no more abilities to unlock and you can just sleep away the day. So to address that, you now have an inspiration meter, which is basically ammunition, and researching is how you restore it. I also want to add a third mechanic to the daytime activities, namely paying the rent. Every few days, your landlord needs to be paid, but you can opt to leave your home and spend time busking for spare change. This will be more of a creeping issue you have to find time for whenever you can, a little curveball for preventing players from settling into a routine. If they fail to pay the rent, well, a game over from being evicted would be a bit anticlimactic for this game, so I think what will happen is that your landlord starts selling your stuff. First your bed, then your desk, leaving you powerless against the escalating horrors. Before we move on, it turns out that in the original story, The Music of Eric Zahn, Zahn plays a viol, which is actually quite different to a violin. It's more like a cello, played while held between the legs. Thank you for informing me, smart asses of the world. In my defense, if you Google Eric Zahn, virtually every image and video you find shows a dude playing a violin. Probably because as an image it works a lot better, the exhausted fiddler standing defiant against the evil, rather than the lazy cellist sitting on their ass, dragging a bow back and forth like they're rubbing their big fat tummy. So yeah, he plays a violin now. I changed it. I can do that. It's public domain.
What's the retro game around 703? I tried googling Nippery Prime and got nowhere.
Oh, you want to know about this, do you? Well, I suppose it would make for a good case study, and it is part of the reason I started this series. Fine, you twisted my arm. Let me tell you all about Space Game the Game. Still haven't thought of a good title for it. You are the captain of a small space-going vessel who awakens to find it stricken by an asteroid strike. A tutorial section ensues, in which your onboard computer walks you through the repairs, closing hull breaches with your welding torch, realigning coolant pipes with your wrench, and removing dirt buildup with a cleansing device. From there, you resume your journey and your actual goal is revealed. As an agent for the Earth Federation, you've been tasked to acquire samples of a rare mineral from a remote planet and then smuggle it back by shutting down all systems and drifting through an enemy blockade, preserving yourself in a cryogenic chamber for the trip. Naturally, something goes wrong and you end up cryogenically frozen and drifting for over 2,000 years, awakening in an unfamiliar universe where the Earth Federation is long gone. And there's nothing left for you to do except get a new ship and try to scrape by making deliveries and various other odd jobs. The idea was to take your Harvest Moon Stardew Valley Workaday Life Sim model, but apply it to a different kind of work and setting. Not planting crops and watering them every day until they sprout, but setting a destination and spending the several days' journey time maintaining your ship's components, then carrying the crates you're delivering down to their destination and receiving payment. That's the primary loop, but not the point of the game. Just as the aim of Stardew Valley isn't the farming in itself, that's just the busy work that connects the points of personal development. Ultimately, the goal is to become part of the community, make friends, find a spouse and squirt out kids, create the story of your life. And Space Game would have gone for something similar, except rather than find a spouse and create a standard family, you would instead build an unconventional family unit, that being a ragtag crew of misfits, in your Red Dwarf Cowboy Bebop Guardians of the Galaxy sort of mold. During your work, you'd stumble upon specific quirky characters with struggles of their own, who one way or another would end up on your crew or a passenger, and as your relationship with them developed, you'd be drawn into their adventure, which would be modelled on the way episodes of Star Trek would usually pick one starring crew member and have them suffer weird sci-fi mishap du jour. Sadly, Space Game still isn't at the stage where I can start adding the NPC crew members in their stories. Turns out that creating the setting for those adventures, an open universe with explorable planets and theoretically infinite random jobs, is a bit of a workload. But that's not really the issue. The issue is that I lost my momentum. I'd do a bit of work, then weeks of procrastination could go by before I could bring myself to playtest it, because I was afraid it wouldn't work or mess up something else in the increasingly complex build and I wouldn't know how to fix it. Towards the end, when I decided I didn't like how the GUIs looked and I was going to overhaul every single one before proceeding, I wondered if perhaps I was subconsciously trying to ensure Space Game would never be finished. After all, if no one ever saw it, no one would ever judge it, and by extension, judge me. I'd been working on it too long and let ego soak in. It's an occupational hazard in this line of work. A good creator puts their work out there, gets the feedback and moves on to the next. You get bogged down with one thing, you get too mentally invested. You become the amateur writer who spends decades endlessly reworking their one great American novel that will totally make them famous and who recoils at the slightest criticism. So I had to do something. I had to shake myself up creatively, light a fire under my sagging motivation, and relearn the fact that I am not my work, to not invest myself too much in any one idea. So I put Space Game on hiatus and publicly declared that I was going to make 12 all new games in 12 months. So there you have it, my sinister origin story. And you know what, 4 games in, I'm getting exactly what I wanted out of Dev Diary. Maybe once it's over I'll go back to Space Game, be ashamed to waste the effort after all, or maybe I'll make something new, but either way I'll have all the energy and motivation I need as soon as Batman is defeated once and for all. I mean, all 12 games are finished.